The White House will mount a public relations campaign to bolster Judge Kavanaugh's image. Sources telling CNN that the Trump's team's plan is to rely heavily on women who know him to vouch for his character.
Let's go to Abby Phillip at the White House. And Abby, I mean, you know, it was so notable, the measured tone and the deliberate word choice that the president made yesterday when talking about Kavanaugh and these allegations, not attacking the character at all or insulting or even questioning the claims of his accuser. The strategy you're hearing will be what going forward?
That's absolutely right, Poppy. Some people even wondered how long something like that could last, but it is part of a strategy that the White House is at least at the moment trying to execute, which is that they want Kavanaugh to defend himself, but they want to avoid being perceived as attacking the alleged victim, attacking his accuser in this case. And in order to do that, they're relying heavily on women, women who say they knew Kavanaugh at that time in his life, who maybe went to school in the same area that both of the parties here involved went to school in suburban Maryland. There was a list that was circulated late last week of 65 women who vouched for Kavanaugh's character. And White House aides tell us that they believe many of those women are willing to stand up and reiterate those claims this week, even after more information has come to light. They've even considered organizing some kind of news conference involving some of these women, talking about the Kavanaugh that they knew and talking about what they believe he was capable of at that time in his life. Now, all of this, of course, going back to the president, relies on President Trump not weighing in a way that the White House or Republican allies believe is damaging to this effort. The president has been measured both on Twitter and in person. He does have a press conference scheduled for later this afternoon, so we'll have another opportunity to see how he chooses to weigh in on this. Meantime, Brett Kavanaugh preparing for potential testimony, and one of the key points there, helping him understand how to defend himself without attacking Dr. Ford. Jim and Poppy.
Abby Phillip at the White House, thanks very much. Joining us now is Sarah Pitlyk. She clerked for Judge Brett Kavanaugh in 2010 to 2011. Thanks so much for joining us this morning, Sarah. We appreciate having you on.
It's my pleasure to be here.
So you wrote, and this was, I should note, before we knew the accuser's name, before she came out publicly, and you said that in your Fox News op-ed, I'm quoting here, that this is direct character assassination, and also, I'm quoting, a last-ditch effort to block his path to the Supreme Court. Now that she is no longer anonymous as she was then, do you still feel the same way?
Well, yes, in a word. We still feel that this allegation is totally inconsistent with the judge that I have known for 10 years, that the world has come to know over the last several months through what has been an extraordinarily thorough vetting process. And so, yes, it is hard to take it seriously in light of all the evidence of Judge Kavanaugh's excellent character and integrity, and also in light of the transparently politically motivated manner in which it's come to light.
So, Sarah, let me ask you about that. When you say these claims that Ms. Ford has made are, quote, hard to take seriously, couldn't it be the case that two things can be true at the same time, that this judge can be, as you wrote in this opinion piece, in your words, quote, wrote about his humility, his generosity, his kindness. You said this is simply not the man we know what he's being accused of. Could both things not be true at the same time, that was your experience with him as you clerked for him, and that this may have been Ms. Ford's experience with him?
I have no experience with Ms. Ford. I don't know anything about her, and I don't claim to know anything about her. All I can speak to is the judge himself and what I and really the whole world at this point know about his character, which is overwhelmingly women have come out of the woodwork through this entire process to testify to the respect with which he treats them, with his championing of us in the workplace and every other context. All I can speak to is the judge. And when I was speaking about the political motivations, I wasn't speaking about his accuser. I was speaking about the process by which this has come forward.
Well, but speaking about the process, I mean, her attorney made clear, the accuser's attorney on CNN yesterday, that they specifically asked Senator Feinstein's office not to release this, to keep this entirely confidential, at the wishes of the alleged victim. but you still believe it is politically motivated. What evidence tells you that?
I'm not a political insider, so I don't pretend to know all of the factors that have been involved here. But as someone observing from the outside, it's just very hard to understand why people have known about this for months, supposedly, why it's evidently, it's an accusation that's more than 3 decades old, and why it would only come to light in the very last seconds of a process that has gone on for months. It sort of defies credibility to believe that it's just a coincidence.
We should be clear here, though, that the timeline from the accuser's perspective, right, is that she raised this in July 2018 before he was, when he was on a short list, before he was the president's nominee here, and she raised it with a tip line to the Washington Post. She then went to her congresswoman, who then passed it on to the senator, et cetera. And she has told friends that part of her difficulty in raising this in years prior was the trauma associated with it, although it did, as we've noted before, come up in a couples therapy session in 2012. That is not an unusual pattern with women who have experienced, and again, I'm making clear here, this is an alleged assault. We're not saying it occurred, but it is a pattern with women who have experienced this kind of behavior to wait because of the shame and the outrage that they might face when they come forward. How is it fair to say that, in your view, is politically motivated?
Again, I don't have anything to say about Ms. Ford or what she has done or why she has done it. What I wrote on Friday and what I still believe is that the process, once she came forward, seems to have been, it's just very difficult to understand why this is all coming out in an extremely contentious 11th hour situation that is going to cause a tremendous amount of delay, to say nothing of the embarrassment and public spectacle for not just the judge and his family, but also the accuser. It seems like if what we were going after here was the truth or justice, this might have played out in a very different way, and that was not quite as damaging for all involved.
And just to be clear before I get to my final question on this, have you spoken to Judge Kavanaugh or anyone close to him in his immediate circle in the last few days about this?
I have not, no.
Okay. So on that point of, you know, getting to justice, right, for all parties here, there is a push now to fully investigate this. You heard Dianne Feinstein, the ranking Democrat on the Judiciary Committee, saying, wait, don't rush this. Take lessons from 91, fully investigate this, right? Have all voices heard equally here. Do you believe that the FBI and members of Congress should fully investigate this, no matter how long it takes? Maybe wait, not have the hearing on Monday, wait for all of the facts from an investigation to come forward? Would that be the, you know, best path towards justice for all?
I defer entirely to the Senate Judiciary Committee on the best way to investigate and consider these claims, as Judge Kavanaugh has as well. They're the experts on this process, not I.
Sarah Pitlyk, thank you for taking the hard questions.
Thanks for being here, Sarah.
Thank you.